Hello everyone. In this video, I'll be talking about acute suppurative otitis media. Acute suppurative otitis media, it is an acute inflammation of middle ear cleft by pyogenic organisms. Middle ear cleft means it includes middle ear, the otitis, otic, the mastoideal cells, and the eustachian tube. These things combine to form middle ear cleft. So inflammation of mucosa of the cleft, it is called acute suppurative otitis media. It is seen more commonly in infants and children and in people with low socioeconomic groups because of unhygienic practices, and it generally follows a viral upper respiratory tract infection where mucosa is inflamed and there is superadded bacterial infection. Now, how the bacteria or the infection reaches the middle ear? So it can reach the middle ear through the eustachian tube, which is the most common route of transmission of infection. And through eustachian tube, either the infection can come through the lumen or through the subepithelial lymphatics. Then in children especially, they have the narrow and very flaccid eustachian tube, shorter eustachian tube, which is more horizontal. It is not inclined at an angle, but it is more horizontal. So those infants who are breastfed, especially in supine position, then there are chances of entry of milk into the middle ear through the eustachian tube, which can also lead to recurrent infections. Then swimming and diving, it can also predispose where the infection can enter the middle ear through the eustachian tube. If the patient is having traumatic perforation or perforation because of any other reason, then the infection can enter into the middle ear through external ear. And very rarely, the infection from some other part of the body can reach the middle ear through blood, which is blood-borne, but it is a very rare source. The most common source of infection of middle ear is through eustachian tube. There are certain predisposing factors for acute suppurative otitis media, like recurrent attacks of common cold, upper respiratory tract infection, measles, diphtheria, whooping cough. So these diseases are more common in children. Therefore, acute otitis media is more common in children. Then recurrent tonsillitis and adenoiditis. Now, because of recurrent attacks of tonsils and adenoids, they act as a reservoir of infection. And from these areas, the infection reaches the middle ear through eustachian tube. Similarly, with rhinitis and sinusitis also, the infection can ascend into the middle ear. Then if there is any allergy, nasal allergy, then it also predisposes to recurrent ear infections. Any tumor or pathology of the nasopharynx, which will hamper the eustachian tube function, can lead to the infection in the middle ear. Then packing of the nose and also cleft palate. So these are some of the predisposing conditions of upper respiratory of acute suppurative otitis media. The organisms which commonly cause acute suppurative otitis media are different in children and adults. So in children, we see that the Streptococcus pneumonia, H influenza, and Moraxella catarrhalis, they are more common in children. While some less common ones are Streptococcus pyogenes, Staphylococcus aureus, and Pseudomonas. The pathology and clinical features of acute suppurative otitis media depends on the stage of otitis media. So for the sake of the clinical features and management, ASOM is divided into five stages. First stage is stage of tubal occlusion. Now here there is some pathology which occludes the eustachian tube opening and which creates negative pressure in the middle ear. So there is a retraction of the tympanic membrane and some amount of sterile effusion collects in the middle ear. So the symptoms will be: the patient will complain of deafness, which will be of conductive type, and earache. However, as there is no infection yet, so there will be no fever. On otoscopic examination, the tympanic membrane will be retracted. The handle of malleus will be foreshortened. Foreshortened means it is not actually shortened, but because it is retracted medially, so on otoscopic examination, it seems to be shortened. Then there will be prominent lateral process of malleus. So the anterior and the posterior malleolar folds, they seem sickle shaped, and there is loss of light reflex, that is the cone of light is absent in the anterior inferior quadrant because of the retracted tympanic membrane. On tuning fork test, there will be conductive hearing loss, that is Rene test will be negative, bone conduction will be more than air conduction, Weber test will be lateralized to the side having more conductive loss, and absolute bone conduction will be normal. Then as the disease progresses, the second stage is stage of pre-suppuration. Now in this stage, the organisms start invading the middle ear. So the sterile fluid, it becomes inflammatory exudate. The tympanic membrane, it starts congesting. So it becomes a congested red in color, and the earache increases. And because there is pus collection in the middle ear, so there is throbbing earache. There is high grade of fever, and the child looks restless. On otoscopic examination, the tympanic membrane will appear like a cartwheel. The tuning fork test will again show the conductive nature of hearing loss. So this is an example of a cartwheel appearance of the tympanic membrane, where we can see that there is a peripheral, there is a leash of blood vessels starting from the center going to the periphery, just like a cartwheel. So this is known as cartwheel appearance of tympanic membrane. Again, as the disease progresses, the third stage is stage of suppuration. Now here there is formation of pus in the middle ear and mastoid ear cell system. The tympanic membrane, it starts bulging to the point of rupture. There is excruciating earache. The deafness increases. There is high grade fever. And sometimes the child especially can have vomiting and convulsions also. On otoscopic examination, the tympanic membrane will be seen as red and bulged with loss of landmarks. That is, no cone of light will be seen. And there sometimes a yellow spot is seen over the tympanic membrane, which is actually the point of the imminent rupture. In this patients, if we get an x-ray done, that is x-ray Schuller's view for mastoid ear cell system, we can see the clouding of the ear cells. That clouding is because of the collection of pus in the mastoid ear cell system. So this is how a tympanic membrane in the stage of suppuration is seen. We can see the bulged tympanic membrane. We cannot appreciate the cone of light in the anterior inferior quadrant, and the whole of the tympanic membrane is bulged and red and congested. The fourth stage is stage of resolution. In this stage, the tympanic membrane ruptures at its weakest point, and all the pus from the middle ear, it is released. And so, because the pus which was under tension, it is relieved, there is subsidence of the symptoms. The fever will go away slowly and the pain subsides. On otoscopic examination, the external auditory canal, we see the bloodstained discharge. It can be purulent also. And on cleaning that discharge, a small perforation is seen, which is most commonly seen in the anterior inferior quadrant. So if proper antibiotics and treatment is given, this small perforation, it heals in due course of time. And finally, there is stage of complications. Now, if the virulence of the organism is high or the resistance of the patient is poor, then the ASOM can complicate into extra or intracranial complications like acute mastoiditis, subperiosteal abscess, facial paralysis, labyrinthitis, petrositis. So these are the extracranial complications. Then extradural abscess, meningitis, brain abscess, or lateral sinus thrombosis, they are some intracranial complications. However, incidence of complications is less in acute suppurative otitis media as compared to chronic otitis media of atequental variety. The management of acute suppurative otitis media includes, first is the cleaning of the ear, that is oral toilet. So whatever pus or discharge is present in the ear canal, it should be cleaned. It can be cleaned with either dry mopping or with suction clearance. Then broad spectrum antibiotics are given to start with. For example, ampicillin, amoxicillin, coamoxiclav, cefixime, erythromycin, cotrimoxazole. Then decongestant nasal drops are given, which will decongest the nasopharyngeal end of Eustachian tube so that ventilation of the middle ear is maintained. Similarly, if the per child is not allowing nasal decongestant drops, then some oral decongestants like pseudoephedrine, phenylephrine can be given. They can be given with combination of antihistaminics. Now, nasal decongestants are oxymetazoline and xylometazoline. Then, to relieve pain and fever, symptomatic management in the form of analgesics and antipyretics can be given. Ear is cleaned and dry local heat is applied, which also relieves pain. If the patient is not getting relieved with these measures, then sometimes myringotomy is required in acute suppurative otitis media. So the indications of myringotomy in acute otitis media are bulging drum with acute pain, which is not relieved by medication, and there is incomplete resolution despite antibiotics. So in spite of giving a proper 14-day course of antibiotics, if either the symptoms persist or if the fluid persists, then myringotomy may be required. So the persistence of fluid beyond 3 months, it requires myringotomy to drain the middle ear fluid. Now this is a figure which shows myringotomy. Now here we can see that there are two myringotomy incisions, incision A and incision B. So incision A is a radial incision which is generally put for secretory otitis media. However, for acute suppurative otitis media, we put a circumferential incision, and circumferential incision is in the posterior inferior quadrant. So for SOM, the incision is radial A in anterior inferior quadrant, and for ASOM, the incision is B circumferential in posterior inferior quadrant. The instrument used for putting incision generally is the Politzer's myringotome. So this is a flow chart which summarizes the management of acute otitis media. So if we diagnose a case of acute otitis media, we start with empirical antibiotic therapy. We review the patient after 2 to 3 days. If the patient is responding, we continue the antibiotic, same antibiotic for 10 days. And after the completion of 14 days, and the patient is treated, then we say it is complete resolution. However, after the initial antibiotic therapy for 3 days, if the earache and the fever persist or increase, then we should consider a change in the antibacterial therapy, or we can give a particular antibiotic according to the culture and sensitivity report of the patient. And that should be continued again for 10 days to make a total 14 days course. After that, if the symptoms are go away, then it is called complete resolution. However, if there is persistent fluid but the symptoms are gone, then that patient is again kept in follow-up for around 3 months. After the 3 months, if the fluid goes, then it is termed complete resolution. Or if the fluid persists, then it is an indication for myringotomy, and then it should be treated in the lines of otitis media with effusion. Thank you.